so most people, I had tried anyway between yesterday and the day before to spend some time with everybody here that I could. So for those of you who haven't, I've been trying to meet everybody and hear their story. That's for me, that's a lot of the reason why I do these things. In the end, I think that the lesson that we learn is that, you know, life isn't about the journey or the destination. It's just about the people you're traveling with. And I think the day that I figured that out, it changed my life. So I focus on the people in my life, which is why I love to come to events like this, because I get a chance to meet you guys, hear your stories, and that's what enriches my life a lot, doing that. We're talking today about legacy and about leaving a legacy and what that means and about giving back. And we touched on that a little bit anyway, but you know, this slide here, and the slides aren't pretty today because I made them myself instead of my design team, but when Sarah challenged me to think about this topic and talk about sort of what it means to me and what I've done in this area and, you know, what we all should be doing, I sat down and wrote it. But I think this was probably the most important philosophy for me personally, which is when it's all said and done, I don't think any of us should be measured. The goal should not be to be measured by the amount of money you make, the number of houses or cars you buy. Our goal for everybody should be measured by the number of lives that were made better in the world because you were in it. How many people's lives did you improve along the way with your success? And it doesn't have to be financial success, with your opportunities, with your life. So I can tell you this, certainly for me, it would be a tragic disappointment if at the end people remember me by saying, oh, that guy made some money or that guy had these businesses or whatever. What I'm hoping for and working for is to have as many people as I can get to in my life say, that person made a positive impact on my life. That person did something with his life that somehow helped me. So that's our topic today, is for all of us to think about, for all the things you do. And by the way, as entrepreneurs, we work hard, right? We work harder. You know, in many cases, in the entrepreneurial lifestyle, when you're doing a startup, you're gone to the world, to your friends, to everything. In fact, one of the most frequent questions I get when I'm on the road speaking about entrepreneurship is people raise their hand and say, this is ruining my relationship. My girlfriend hates me. My boyfriend's sick of my working hours. How do you balance that stuff? Balance is hard. There's no doubt. But one thing is simple. Success doesn't come without hard work and sacrifice. So if we're going to do all this hard work and we're going to give all this sacrifice and we're going to pay prices for it, without a doubt, we should use that. We should get something for all that effort. And the get something is that it gives us the ability to impact a lot of lives here. So an interesting thing to me, and this is what I want to start with today, talking about, I do speak at a lot of schools and universities, et cetera. But recently, I got a call from a school, and they said, Jeff, we want you to speak at Career Day. And I was like, are you sure you dialed the right number? My name's pretty common. And she said, why do you say that? And I said, because I don't have, per se, a career, right? Career Day is doctors and lawyers and nurses. And I went to one Career Day, and there was actually an astronaut there, right? I remember when I was 5, I was going to be an astronaut, and there was an astronaut at Career Day. So they called and said, we want you to come to Career Day. Well, my whole life, my friends have always said, dude, when are you going to get a career? Because I was always doing something different. And, you know, I guess to them, sadly, I was on a rate where, you know, our companies were getting acquired every 3 years. So 3 years later, I was doing something different. And they're like, you're just unstable. So if it's bad that you build a company and somebody buys it from you in 3 years, then yeah, I'm unstable. But what was interesting to me was I said, all right, I don't understand. And they said, and this was so exciting to me and encouraging, they said, we finally realized that entrepreneurship is a choice. It's actually career. My whole life, being a lot older than you guys, I've always been the guy that everybody thinks can't seem to figure out what he wants to do because he's always doing something different. I kept quietly thinking to myself, wait, what if the thing that I want to be able to do in my life is always do something different? Why is that not a career choice? Well, guess what? It has a name now. The career is entrepreneur. The field is entrepreneurship. They teach it. It's cool. You can get a degree in entrepreneurship. And guess what? It's now part of Career Day. So I had an absolute blast going to Career Day and explaining to kids, that is not me, in fact, I just couldn't find a good enough picture, explaining to kids, but that's not bad, except that the kids look like, why do we have to be in here? Explaining entrepreneurship is a career. So that got me thinking, and this is a question I hope you've all already asked yourself, and if you haven't, because you move at such light speed, you should. And I would love to hear some of your answers, by the way. Why are you an entrepreneur? Why did you? I can tell you my reasons. I chose this as a career path specifically. I didn't stumble into entrepreneurship because I didn't have a job or I couldn't find something to do. I chose this intentionally because this is the life that I wanted. But it made me think about it. Why do people become entrepreneurs? Why did you make this choice? And there are a lot of reasons. For me, this was the big one. I worked briefly in corporate America. I believe that it hated me as much as I didn't get along with it. Me and corporate America were not friends very well. I just, the silliness factor drove me nuts all the time. And I literally, every time I'd go to a weekly staff meeting, I couldn't get the image out of my head of lemmings just pouring off cliffs to their death, but they were following their boss. Okay, because my boss was constantly leading us over a cliff, and I just got tired of raising my hands and saying, won't we all die if we do that? My boss saying, I'm the boss here, just follow me over the cliff. So I just couldn't work in that environment anymore. I didn't necessarily think that I was knew better than anybody else, but I understood this. I wanted to live or die by my own sword. If I make mistakes and fall, I want to make mistakes and fall because I got it wrong, get up, learn something, and move on. I just wanted the freedom to follow my instincts, to try my ideas, and to be able to live in a world that was much freer of just silliness. We spent most of our time trying to please internal management. And I kept saying, shouldn't we be spending all our time trying to please the customer, and we should get promoted because the customer was happy? And people would say, you're an idiot. You get ahead here by pleasing the VP. That's the guy that does promotions. So freedom was my reason for becoming an entrepreneur. I just wanted to be free of that. Some people become an entrepreneur because they want to change the world. They have an idea, and I hope that's a lot of people, that they literally believe will have an impact on the world and change the world. That's a very, very important goal. By the way, it can be a mix of these goals. Some people weren't trying to change the world, weren't really looking for freedom. They just stumbled upon a problem, and they said, wow, this problem has to be fixed, and I'm the girl to do it. So sometimes people see a wrong in the world that needs to be righted, or they see an opportunity to make something better by solving a problem. That's the reason some people become an entrepreneur. Now, we can't doubt this. And this is what I don't like about things like, you know, social network, the Facebook movie. It actually gives entrepreneurship a bad name. You know why? Because it gives the image that all of us are just trying to all we care about is getting rich, and we're all trying to create, the only thing that matters in entrepreneurship is the next Facebook or whatever. That's absurd, right? All over the world, entrepreneurship is the art and science of starting your own business. It doesn't have to become a billion-dollar business. It does not have to be an internet business, and you do not have to get rich to be successful. We just talked about all these other things that you could be doing that you may not even get rich doing that are extremely important. There are people who've changed the world and did not get rich doing it. That doesn't mean that that shouldn't be one of your goals, right? I made money as an entrepreneur. I didn't try not to do that as part of the scorekeeping system, but it's not what drives me. I didn't wake up every day dreaming about making the next dollar. But it's out there. Making money is one of the reasons people become an entrepreneur. And the truth is, when an entrepreneur, there's a direct relationship between the value you create and the compensation you get. That's not really true in large companies because they can't do that, right? You have a job grade 28, level 6, and there's a cap on what you can make. And I remember thinking, why isn't the cap related to the value I contribute? Well, it is in the entrepreneurship world. The more value you contribute, the more you get compensated. That's the free enterprise system that built this country and made the world great. And now it's a global thing that everybody can participate in. You should be rewarded for the value you create in the world. And then the other piece is just to have control of your own destiny, right? When you are an entrepreneur, you have more freedom to design your life around you and the people in your life to make it fit. So there are a lot of reasons, but here is a really important question, though. You just all need to ask yourself, why am I following this path? What is my primary goal? What am I trying to achieve by being an entrepreneur? Am I trying to change the world? The reason this is important is because how are you going to keep score otherwise? How do you know if you're achieving your goal if you're not clear on what it was? Mine was simple. It wasn't to make money, but I needed money to do this. My goal was to never have to go ask for a job again. Somebody once asked me for a resume, and it occurred to me that I've never had one because I never went out job hunting. That was my goal. I just want to live my own life. I don't want to ever be in that sometimes degrading line of begging somebody to hire me. And I'm just giving you a very editorial opinion, but I had a goal. I had a reason to work really hard, was to gain my freedom. What is your reason? You really should think about why you're an entrepreneur and why you're willing to live this lifestyle and make these sacrifices and work this hard, because there was something that you were trying to achieve. But here's the one that it turns out is the biggest and most important one of all, which is to live a life of purpose, right? And I'll tell you guys, to be very honest, the first time I sold my first startup was a software company. I sold it to American Express. I was in my 20s. We sold the company for millions of dollars. And I woke up the next day, not thrilled and elated, but concerned, because I wasn't sure what I was going to do now. I sat there. I literally was adrift a little bit without purpose. And I will admit, I did the stupid things. I built a house that my friends called Chateau Hoffman, had rooms I never went in. And it turns out that was really meaningless. Kind of the achievement of that was about as empty as those rooms were. And I thought, well, that was it. I worked all this hard so I could build a house or something. It just actually was a really depressing day for me, much more so than I thought. Plus, when you guys are young and successful, you look at all the years ahead of you and you almost say, now what? You know, one of my big bucket list things was to be successful in business. If you do that early, you suddenly find yourself without a rudder a little bit. But I will tell you a story that happened one day. I was, and I talked about this with you guys a little bit yesterday, I saw a news story about a battered women's shelter. Oh, and by the way, all my friends hated me when I sold my first company. People that were friends, all of a sudden, it's like having a winning lottery ticket. All of a sudden, because you made money, everybody hates you. And that's how it felt. It's nobody's patting you on the back. They resent you now, all of a sudden. And I just wasn't prepared for the negative part of the more money, more problems thing. But I got a lot more negative reaction. I almost felt bad. There were days I just wish this hadn't happened because my life in some ways has a lot more negativity in it before I had a dime in it. But anyway, so I'm feeling kind of bad about all this. And one morning I see this news story about this battered women's shelter. Everybody's crying because they're closing the shelter because they haven't paid their mortgage for 4 months and they're being evicted. And they're saying, where will these women go? I guess back to the place that sent them there, right? The ultimate horror. And I remember, just as I told you guys yesterday, sitting there and thinking, boy, I hope they do something. I hope somebody helps them. And I turned off the TV and I sat there that night thinking, wait a minute, why am I not that somebody? And you know what happened to me? I had the epiphany. I connected the dots. All of a sudden it occurred to me why I worked really hard and why I did make money and why it mattered. It didn't matter to build a house. It mattered because all of a sudden I was that somebody that could fix that problem. And so we literally the next morning got on the phones, tracked this thing down, paid all their back rent, paid a year's worth of their mortgage. We did it all anonymously. But we solved a problem in the world. I saw the news story the next night that they were all crying again, but this time they were happy. Some anonymous person paid for the next year of their life so that they didn't have to shut down the women's shelter. You know what happened? Instead of feeling bad about making money, I couldn't wait to start something else, make more money, and do that again, and solve more problems. It was the ability to impact other people's lives positively that gave me the purpose for getting up every day and wanting to launch another company. And I never again felt bad about making money because some problems, and we're going to talk about ones that don't, some problems actually need money to solve and somebody's got to do it. So what you should be saying to yourself is, I'll be the person to do that. Why not you? There isn't somebody else if we all say that. So living a life of purpose is something that an entrepreneur has a wonderful opportunity to do. For me, I think entrepreneurship is a platform. It's a privilege to be an entrepreneur. I'm proud of this career choice that I spent my whole life defending, because what is wrong with this unstable guy, Jeff, who keeps stumbling around doing different things? Now people recognize that this was what I wanted to do. But it's a platform and it's an ability to make a difference in the world. You as an entrepreneur, part of your goal should be to find a way to make the world around you a better place. And I will say this, there's no excuse. I used the word weak yesterday when people tell me, yeah, Jeff, I'll do something when I make money. That's just a weak answer. And I'll be honest, I wish I had realized that because I would have done more before, you know, without money before I ever could. But there's no excuse anymore in this world for you not finding ways to use your life for a greater sense of purpose than just trying to make money. You can do that too. When you make money, you can use it for good, but don't tell me you're not going to do anything until then. Entrepreneurship is a platform that enables you to do this. Now, interestingly, when I talk about that, some people say to me, well, my business doesn't lend itself to helping people. If your business was, you know, I think that's a Habitat for Humanity picture. If your business was in some business, that your business by its definition makes the world a place. If you're working on the clean water problem or feeding the world or a lot of things, health-related things, a lot of you have startups that your actual product makes the world a better place. But every startup doesn't do that. So people say, well, my business doesn't lend itself to that. Maybe I make these glasses or whatever. Your business doesn't. Your life does. Okay? Your life always lends itself to finding a way to help other people, regardless of what your business does. I'll give you some examples in a minute. But here is, I'm going to challenge you all to do this, including people that are watching this as it's webcast or on the internet. One of the things that you need to do is sit down and ask yourself, the really hard question, what matters to me in life? What do I want my life to be? And here's specifically what I want you guys all to do. And I'm going to ask you to do something. You don't have to do this, but I would love, when you do this, people that are here in the room today, write them down. I'd love you to give them to me. I'd love to share them, to look at them, to kind of cross-section them. People that are watching this online, my email is jeff@colorjar.com. It's on the last slide. Send them to me. I want you to take a sheet of paper, and I want you to write down a sentence. And this sentence is, it's the end of your life, looking back, what is the one sentence? What do you want people to say about you? What is the thing, if somebody's going to say something, hey, do you remember Jeff? Yes, he what? What is that sentence? Why are you doing this? Because if you have this as your guiding principle, this what you want people to remember you for, it will guide you to making good choices along the way if you know what the end game is. What you don't want to do is get to the end of your life and say, I'm not really sure what I was trying to get done here. So I thought long and hard about what do I want to be remembered for. I have a friend who's a professional boxer, Evander Holyfield. And I remember having this conversation with him. I said to the guy, boxing ended, he was retiring. I said, do you want to be remembered for your left hook? And he said, no, I want to be remembered for the number of children in the inner city that I gave hope and chance to. So you know what we did? It wasn't until the day he thought about that, we created a scholarship fund together. And every year we would send 20 inner city kids that would have never gone to college if he hadn't been successful in boxing and if he hadn't I put this fund together. We sent 20 kids a year to college, all expenses paid on us, that would have never left the hood if they didn't have this program. But he didn't get there until the day he sat and said to himself, I want to be remembered for getting kids in the inner city out of the inner city, not because I knocked out Mike Tyson. You need to do the same thing. What do you want people to say about you when it's all over? Then you need to literally make a list. Look at the world around you and make a list from time to time. What are things that you can do? What could you do? Things that don't require money. An example we talked about yesterday when Aurel had you do the pledges. Examples are mentoring, whether it's mentoring students. An example is I was on the board of Big Brothers Big Sisters for a while. What a phenomenal program. It's people that said, what can I do to make the world around me better? I can go find a child that has no role model and be a role model for that person. I can be there when they have a really tough time. I got a really deep insight to that one time at a Christmas event in the inner city in New York where everybody was bringing Christmas presents. And there was one little boy, I got talked into dressing up as Santa. I was one little boy that, for the life of him, little 10-year-old Puerto Rican boy that was not going to smile. And he got a truck, which he took the truck, but he wouldn't smile, and all the kids were laughing and having fun. And I sat, this was a life-changing moment for me. At the end, I took the kid into the hall, I took the beard off, I said, all right, I give up. I said, we've tried everything we can to give you, to make you smile, to make you laugh. It's Christmas time, you got great new toys. And I said, what do I got to do to, I said, I'm not leaving this building till you smile once. So what do I have to do? And what this kid said to me really, really struck me. What he said was, we appreciate the Christmas party. We appreciate that all you people show up one day a year at Christmas to bring us presents. He said, my problem is I can't get, sorry, this gets me emotional. He said, I can't get through the other 364 days. And this is a 10-year-old kid. And he said, where were you when they broke the door down and tried to kill my sister? And he said, and where were you when my father was beating up my mother and I was too small to pull him off? And I sat there feeling like the biggest fool in the world, because I'll show up at Christmas and donate presents, but what was I doing the rest of the year to help that kid? You know what? That didn't cost money. That kid said, I just wish I had someone to talk to every once in a while. So I started making a list after that day, saying, what are things I can do in my local community that would improve somebody's life and would enhance somebody? There's no excuse for me not being able to make myself available to a kid like that somewhere in the world. If each of us does that somewhere, we can get something done. And you know what I do now? I constantly go back and look at that list. And I say, am I doing these things that I said I could do to make the world around me a better place? So this is my challenge to you. Take that sheet of paper and write down what you want people to say about you when your life and your career are over. Make a list of ways you can get there and don't forget it. Constantly check it. Make sure you're taking a piece of your life to do that. Now, these next two slides are just because, like I said, some people told me, well, my business doesn't lend itself. We're not building a business to make the world a better place. We're not filtering drinking water. We're not curing diseases or whatever. Well, that's pretty weak. My business is, one was a travel business, right? Even before Priceline, I was in the travel business. We sell airline tickets. That's not really making the world a better place. In fact, the segment of the population that flies is a very small segment. So we weren't feeding the hungry with this business. I had another business when I ran a company called ubid.com. We sold electronics and jewelry on the internet. right? We were an auction site, and the internet's not making the world a better place. The people in the world that most need help are not the people buying 60-inch flat screen TVs on the internet. So you could come up with an excuse, and you could say, well, my business doesn't lend itself to doing that. But like I said before, there are a lot of things that you can find to go do in the world as ways to help out there. We all said, by the way, that mentoring is one of the biggest ones. A lot of times, this is interesting because a lot of times people, you know, well, when people come, they're just asking me to give money to something. But this is my personal editorial opinion. I think the most valuable asset is our time, not our money. There's money, and a lot of people need money, but there are more places that will write a check than there ever are people who will donate their time to go help and spend time with people. So the most valuable gift you have is your time, is your expertise, your talent, your passion, and your heart. So find ways to give it. So even though my companies weren't in businesses that were changing the world, we took the time to be good citizens. I asked all my employees, look around the community and figure out something we could do. But here's what's important for you guys as leaders, CEOs, and founders. Build that into your company. So this is one. For 4 years, I was the chairman of a National Association for Disabled Children. We created sporting leagues for kids that couldn't play sports anywhere else. And it was called adapted sports. You can see it on the jersey. You can play wheelchair basketball if you have arms. But how do you play if you have no arms? We adapted the sport so every kid, regardless of disability, could play. But my employees would come out and to these events and push the kids that couldn't push their own wheelchair around. When we played wheelchair football, we were wheeling them up and down the field. Everybody was screaming and laughing. But you know what that was? That was actually part of a work day. That afternoon was during the week, and I let all my employees go. You know what we have to do? That means we're going to have to work nights or weekends to make up for that so that we can still have a successful business. That's a life choice. No employee was required to do this. That's not my point. My point is that when an employee wanted to help, I never penalized them for that. You can never be the boss that says, so that means you're going to be out Tuesday? Right? You need to design your life, your company, as good citizens. Design your world so that helping others is part of what you do. My employees would say, we're all going to go push wheelchairs on Wednesday. We'll all come in Saturday to make up for it. And I would say, usually, you guys don't have to do that, and they would do it anyway. Build citizenship into the business that you build and allow them to do it. We had wonderful experiences doing this, but our whole company supported this. I found ways, both in the company and without, I'm going to skip these pictures, but I did a whole series of charity events that we did as a company. These were company events that we donated money. We built summer camps for children that we did on a deal with some of our clients and friends in the music business. But we helped build and run summer camps for children. We did donations to all kinds of inner city organizations. But we went out, just that slide I showed you a minute ago, that the thing that Elton John and I did, I didn't know the guy. Here's an amazing thing in life. You know this already. You miss 100% of the shots you don't take, right? So you know what we did? I just sent a note to Elton John's management company and said, here is something that I would like to do. If the microphone goes off, does that mean I should shut up and stop talking? Because the microphone, I think, just went off. I just sent the guy a note and said, hey, we'd love to do this charity thing. We'd love to have you help with it. And you know, you never know until you try, and it turned out that he and I wound up doing a series of charity concerts together. But guess what magical thing I did to make that happen? I asked, okay, would you do this with me? And he said, love the idea, and let's go raise money for charities in our community. And I luckily got this British piano player to come play the piano. A lot of people paid for that, and I gave all the money to charity. All I did was ask. We even did things like, I'm just giving you this as an example. I asked my employees to look around the community and see what we could help with. This was just a quick example that the zoo in Atlanta was trying to import the second pair of mating pandas ever in the United States outside the National Zoo down the street. So our company, all my employees volunteered this day, and we helped bring the pandas to Atlanta. We had an inner city school day at the zoo that we closed the zoo. All my employees volunteered. We fed all the kids. We let them meet the pandas. This wasn't about money. It was about being involved in our community and citizenship. So what can you guys do to do this? Again, think about it yourself, talk to your employees and your team. What are you passionate about? If you're passionate about children's causes, then that's what it is. If you're passionate about making sure no one's homeless, if you're passionate about education, about health, find some things that you care about. Start by donating your time even before you have any money, because it will make a difference. When you are successful, also donate your money. We honored some winners here yesterday in the Empact Social category, but when I was judging those companies, so many of you who are already making your first dollars ever in business are giving it back. I was so proud. I called Sarah, and Sarah said, you have to pick a winner. And I said, I picked it. They're all the winner. Sarah said, Jeff, we have to pick one. I said, there's no way, Sarah. So many of these people in this room are doing amazing things with their time and their money. Before they've even made real money, they're already giving it back. I was really proud of you guys and to be associated with Empact in this. And then, like I said, mentor others. Because our job is, one of the most fulfilling calls I ever got was I got a call from a young lady that said, I was stuck in my life, and she attended something I spoke at, and she said, you inspired me to break the logjam. And she said, your speech that night was the inspiration that got me up to go do something. I launched my businesses, and it's successful. And she said, I know there's no way I could pay you back. And she said, but I looked all around my community, went to some schools, and I found the next me, and I'm helping her get to where I just got. And she said, that's the way I'm paying it back. I can't think of a better solution, right? And guess what that girl's going to do? Probably the same thing. That is the world I want to live in anyway, where everybody says it's my job to reach my hand behind me and pull somebody up. All of us can do that. Mentorship is really important. We already talked about this. What can your company do? Be a good citizen. Let your team look around the community and find something you can help with. Talk to other companies in your industry and see what they're doing. Team with people because it reduces the workload. And like I said, encourage your employees to do things in your community. Don't punish them for the time. If somebody says, I'm not going to be in Wednesday because we're going to build a house for some people, you should be celebrating, not penalizing that. The rest of your team should cover for them. And when you can, set aside a portion of your money. To do this, you have to build a plan. When you write that sheet of paper that I told you to write, what do I want to be remembered for? Then you need to be building a plan that actually gets you to that part when people remember you at the end of your career or your life. You're not going to get there if you don't start planning for it now. I had an idea of what I wanted to achieve with my career as I was going, and build a roadmap of how you can do that. A legacy is not an accident. A legacy is a plan. Here's what I want to contribute to the world as I go through it. Write down those goals, write down that plan, and constantly look at it and say, am I doing something to achieve this plan? Am I actually building my legacy? Because I'm too busy is a weak excuse. Find the time. That's what entrepreneurs do. Entrepreneurs find a way to get it done. That is your DNA. So use it a little bit and make sure that you constantly read and adjust that plan. So I'm going to leave you guys with that challenge. But I'm going to tell you the thing that I always ask myself. This is the standard I'm trying to hold myself up to. I constantly ask, what have I done recently to make somebody else's life better? And if I can't answer it, I need to get my butt up and go do it. Thank you guys. And I hope to all of you, I hope people keep in touch. And like I said, email me those mission statements because I love to see what you guys are doing with your lives. Thanks.